Welcome back, everybody. This is the Motivic Geometry Seminar, and Kai will give his third lecture in his lecture series, please.
Yes, okay, thank you. So as promised, today I come to the more recent work. So this is about the general properties of cohomology sheaves, of cohomology of reciprocity sheaves, and then also, we give examples of what we get. And so this is joint work with Federico Binder and Shuji Saito. So first, now we have to restrict a little bit, we have to restrict the modulus pairs with which we can work. Namely, now we mostly consider LS modulus pairs, which are so now we assume also that X itself is smooth. Yeah, before only the complement of X by D was smooth. Now the whole X is smooth, and then the support of D should be a simple normal crossing divisor. But still we allow multiplicities in D. And then we will say, so when we have a morphism between smooth schemes and D is as above, then we say that this is transversal to D if you take any number of irreducible components, you intersect them, and then you look at the inverse image, and then you want that this is again a regular closed immersion of codimension R. So this is a kind of very restrictive condition, which we unfortunately need. It says essentially that there's nothing interesting happening over D. So it's over D, it has to be smooth essentially itself. Okay. So now let me come to the first result, namely the projective bundle formula. So now in this setup, we have G is now a cube invariant sheaf, which has this, all this nice properties. So it has this M reciprocity, it's semi-pure, and it's a Nisnewitz sheaf. And then we have such an LS modulus pair. And so we have a projective bundle of rank N, something like Pn over X. And then we can pull back the divisor D, which is sitting here in this curly X. We pull it back to P. So we have another modulus pair here. That's also an LS modulus pair. And then the formula is that when we, so this is now a sheaf on P, but we keep track here of this modulus also. And when we push it forward to X, then it decomposes like this. And this gamma I, this is the one which I introduced yesterday. So these are the this is the inner HOM in the category of modulus sheaves with transfers from the ith Milner K theory to G. Okay, so this is probably what you expect a projective bundle formula to look like, but it's interesting now to see what it gives you in the examples. So for example, when you are in characteristic zero, and now we take for G, we take the Kähler differentials, absolute Kähler differentials, and then this tilted version. Yeah? So this where the sections are given by A, by those A's which have a certain modulus. And so yesterday I explained an explicit computation of this tilde, when in characteristic zero, when you have omega j tilde. And it was what I said was local, but you can also see that this gives you this global description. Yeah? So this is like omega j tilde and then on p comma dp. And so here you have log poles at d, and then you have here, you allow poles at here's this divisor is D minus the reduced of D. So this is this is short for your tensor with O of this divisor. And then the formula looks like this, where we need also that this gamma I of the Kähler differentials, of the J scalar differentials, is an omega J minus I. So when you neglect the D here, the twist, then this is the usual projective bundle formula, which you know for Kähler differentials. And so this is, this is already somewhere in SGA 7 or, yeah. So this is really classical. And but it's interesting to see. I mean, this formula you can also prove, of course, directly by hand. But it's not the one which you just get by projective, by the projection formula when you're tensor with OD or something. Yeah. So it's a little bit finer here. So when you want to get this version, then you have to reprove the projective bundle formula in this case directly by hand. And this finer version, so to say, is what we get here automatically, at least after we computed all the terms. And then just as another example, of course, you can apply this to all the examples which we discussed so far. Yeah, although not in all examples, we know really how the modulus sheet looks like. And so here is an example where I just take D to be the empty divisor. And so then I have just, then I'm just on P here, and here I'm just on X. And then we can plug in these sheaves here. Yeah? So this is this certain etal motivic cohomology sheaf. And again, from the formulas we saw yesterday and the fact that this gamma on this level is exact here, this gamma i's, one can easily deduce that gamma I of this one is this here. Yeah? So you get this minus I here and here. And so one gets this formula. And now, if you remember yesterday that I was talking about this work in progress, which summer was about computing the tilted version of these sheaves. And of course, you don't remember this formula for the filtration, which is a good candidate for it. But maybe you remember that it was looking quite complicated. Yeah. So, and somehow here you get such a formula, which then directly keeps track of this. Of this filtration. And so when you want to prove it by hand, I mean, sure you can do it, but I'm sure also it's lots of work. Okay, so this is a projective bundle formula. Then you get, of course, also the blow up formula. Again, we are in the same situation as before. We take a GE cube invariant sheaf here and take such a LS modulus pair. And now we give ourselves a regular closed immersion of codimension C, which is transversal to D, and we blow up X in this Z. So X tilde is a blow up. And then we can pull back the divisor D here to the blow up and also to Z. And then the blow up formula is like this, which again is maybe what you expect. Yeah, so this is in the derived category of sheaves on X. Nissen-Rich sheaves on X. And of course, I mean, then again, you can find all kinds of explicit examples here in this situation, you know, when you plug in the examples which we discussed before. And let me say some words on the proof. So I cannot say so much, but I mean, the proof is really there's a part where one has to be, I mean, you have to do something new, yeah. So it's not just like modifying Voivodsky's argument. And so the first thing is that the proof of the projective bundle formula and the blow up formula, they are enmeshed, yeah. So somehow first you have the projective bundle formula in the for P1. This is coming from the cube invariants and Saito's theorems. And then you want to do induction, and so when you have a Pn. Then you blow up a point, and then you can fiber this blow up as a projective bundle of a smaller rank over the exceptional divisor. And so you use then the project the blow up formula and the projective bundle formula in smaller rank to get the projective bundle formula in higher rank. So at the end, the main point plus lots of technicalities, which are more or less standard. The main point then remains is that you have to understand the following. So if you take a line in A2 through zero, and you blow up A2 in the origin in zero, so this is Y, then you have to understand, or then you want to show that when you take your G and you restrict it to Y, the pullback of L, you want to show that the higher direct images here vanish. Yeah, so this is it. Sorry, what was her? question? No.
I don't think so, just...
Okay, sorry. So you want to show that the higher direct images here vanish, which essentially means you want to show that the first higher direct image vanished. And now you can fiber this blow up here also over P1. Here you have the exceptional divisor inside, and then this is maps isomorphically here. So this is the map which parametrizes the lines through zero in A1. And this is an A1 bundle. And then you can show that the higher direct images here also vanish. So everywhere here we use these results by Saito, yeah, the purity results. And at the end you are left to show this here, when you push forward G with this decoration here to this P1, you want that the first cohomology vanishes. Well, and then this is you do a hands-on, do a hands-on computation somehow. So you cover this Y by open subsets where you then know how it looks, and then you have to follow how you glue the maps together. And so at the very end, so what you see is that this relies on the following. So this vanishing. So we define this cube n, this is P1, and then with n times zero plus n times infinity. And so here we have this map. Yeah, so this is, you see, I mean, so I should say this little s here, this is not a scheme, this is a parameter. Yeah? So I mean, without infinity, this is spec of the polynomial ring in Ks. Yeah? S is a variable here. So this is like the basis here. And then in one chart above, you have a coordinate x. So you have an a1 in one chart, and then you have an ay in the other chart. And then this here is like this chart changing map, yeah, this gluing map for this blow up here. So this is, you go x goes to y times s. And you see, when I have here the divisor, for example, at zero, I have here a zero here and a zero here. So the function corresponds to x times s. And this is sent then to y times s squared. So this is why here a two appears. And and then here you have a natural map, which is a surjection. So you have a natural map of this modulus pairs here, and then on these quotients here, you get a surjection. And so, I mean, maybe I should say again. So this is here the Z trace of this, and then you look at the cube invariant quotient, and then you semi-purify it, and then you Nisnevichificate it. And then here you have this surjective map. And then, so this vanishing at the end is implied when you see that, when you can say that this map here exists. Yeah, so this is surjective. You have to show that everything which goes to zero here also goes to zero here. Now, by semi-purity meant that when I'm on XD, then I have an injection to X without D, empty set, yeah, on the sheaf level. Yeah, the restriction map is injective. And since these are all semi-pure, it suffices to check this after applying this omega lower shriek, yeah, so going to the complements. And then we have this formula here, which follows from this paper with Sugiyama and Yamazaki, so the computation of this is the second minor K-series, this is GM plus GM plus Z, which is homotopy invariant Nisnevich sheaf. And so you see that this map here, this is homotopy invariant. So this map factors actually via the homotopy invariant quotient of this. And then you can show that it's exactly this. So then it factors like this. Okay, and so this is one of the main points here. And then...
Kai, just there's a question for you in the chat, if you can...
How do I... Is semi-purity related to almost purity? almost purity in the sense of faltings? Or? No, it's not related. Yeah, no, it's not related. So semi-purity, yeah, unfortunately, this is too much. So semi-purity means when I have a G of X, D, this is injective inside G of X without D, empty set. So you have an injection. Okay, so this is not related to this almost purity. So this was one point in the proof. Of course, I mean, you cannot understand the proof from this, but I just wanted to point out, I mean, there's really something new here. These higher modulus occurs. Okay, and then in the blow up sequence, I mean, you construct it as a blow up sequence originally, and then you have to define a splitting, and then this is done in a similar way as Wolodzki did it. Yeah, Wolodzki uses A1 invariants at some point there, you use in cube invariants, and then it's the same thing. And then also you can use this in the same way to define a Gaussian map, so the definition is very analog to what Wolodzki does. And then you get from this, you can also get a Gaussian sequence. So this takes the following. So G is as before, and XD is an LS pair, and you have this regular closed immersion. You have again the blow up. E is the exceptional divisor. And then the Gaussian sequence is like this. So you have an exact triangle in the derived category of sheaves, Nisnewitz sheaves on X. Which looks like this. So here, this is a Gaussian map, and here we have to pull back to the blow up, and we allow here, so we enlarge the modulus by E, and then we have here a boundary map to this. And now this looks on the first sight a little bit different than what Wolodzki is doing. Yeah, so for example, if you just have D is the empty set, yeah, so then you talk about the usual sheaves on smooth schemes, then you have here just G on Z, here you have G on X, but here you have G on X tilde comma E. And but the thing is that when G is homotopy invariant, then this here is actually the same as G on, so RJ lower star of G on the complement X tilde without this. So,
sorry, what is this exact triangle? Is it in the category of Nisnewitz sheaves with M core correspondences, or where is it?
No, it's just it's in the derived category of Nisnewitz sheaves of abelian groups on X. This is really because we fix already X. So in one way, of course, I mean, like when you have a full working motivic theory, yeah, then you would like to have it more general. You just write some functors where you can then evaluate everything.
Yeah, but on the other hand, starting with M core correspondences, I understand that there are chiffification functors which should be compatible with M core correspondences, and mm-hmm. If I clearly understand, the homotopy invariance is replaced with cubical invariance in there.
Invariance, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Is the definition of Vygotsky's category DM effective for M core correspondences? Like it is the full subcategory of complexes of Nisnewitz sheaves with M core correspondences with how is it called, invariant sheaves?
Yeah. Well, I think this was the plan at the beginning. This was really what Kan Saito Yamazaki wanted to do, but I think it didn't work. It's not written completely so far. Yeah. So, I don't know what the status is on this. Yeah. But it's not.
I see. So, but anyway, the definition, like I have mentioned, does not exist yet.
You can define it, but then I don't know whether you get all the properties which you want.
Okay, thank you. Thank
you. Okay. So yeah, I mean, maybe I should have said at the beginning. I think this theory, I mean, it gives many nice properties and generalizes many points, but I think it's not complete at the moment. Yeah, it's far from being complete. So it's there's still lots of things to do. Yeah, and maybe it will change a lot in the next years. Yeah, but it's. I mean, but what you see already is that you get, I mean, considering this more general situation, you get many new results and interesting results. So it's really worth working on it. Yeah, so, and I wanted to say that this, when you have a homotopy invariant sheaf, then this here is just Rj lower star when J is embedding of the open complement into X tilde. Of the open complement here, and then but then the blow up over the open is just an isomorphism, and then it looks like you think, yeah. So then you have here, then you go to Rj lower star of G on the open on the complement of Z. And but so somehow this is, for example, something which wasn't clear before. Yeah, what should be the, I mean, how to generalize this Bayesian sequence? Yeah? And then you really need here this modulus or at least log schemes. Yeah. So there is also such a sequence in the theory by Bindo, Park, and Östwa on the for the motifs. Yeah. So that's representable by motifs. This is maybe conceptually nicer, but somehow it also, so they don't have the multiplicity in here. And then to have it like this, really, as on a sheaf theoretic level, then you would also have to extend this theory of motifs really to like a full-fledged sixth functor formalism, as Sisinski and Diglis do it for in Voivodsky's case. Okay, so let me also spell out maybe some examples here. So there is, of course, the first example. You can again take Kähler differentials, and then you plug in the formulas which we had before. And well, and then you get an exact sequence which I haven't seen for the Kähler differentials before. Yeah, it seems even in characteristic zero, this is new. The Gaussian sequence was there, but that you have really an exact sequence like this, I wasn't aware of this. Yeah, at least, well, of course, you have it when Z is has codimension one, because then this map is here just like the residue. But in higher codimensions, I haven't seen this. Yeah, so. Let us consider a more interesting example. So we now plug in these connections, yeah, rank one connections on X, whose irregularity is bounded by D. Yeah, so this we had yesterday, this description. Then we can map them here. And then this is here, this boundary map of this Gaussian sequence. And what we use here is that one description of this is, this is H0 of this group. Yeah, so this is not so hard to see, well, at least without D. And and then when you apply the gamma, this gamma functor, then it cancels here the one, and it makes the O star to a Z. So this is then what remains. And so this sequence is, you can also construct by hand. Yeah. I should say Z is now a divisor, so the blow up, of course, coincides then with Z, and this is like the exceptional divisor before, so we have just this. And here, this is then the residue map. Yeah, so this you can construct by hand. But then that this sequence goes on like this, I think this is not clear, yeah, and I haven't seen this before. And so, for example, if you take D is a divisor which is ample enough, then this group will vanish. And then, you know, when you have a function here which has certain poles along a divisor which is ample enough, then you can lift this function to a regular or to a connection of rank one which has this prescribed irregularity. And I think if you want to do it by hand, I mean, then you have to work a lot on. Well, and if you do if the codimension of Z is greater or equal to, then like in this first degree zero part, then this part here is also zero. So then you have this isomorphism here. So like rank one connections on X, D, I mean, so on X, which have the regularity bounded by D, are the same as rank one connections on the blow up where you where you might have also some irregularity at E. And you can do the same also with list sheaves. Yes, when you have this list one, this is a sheaf whose sections over X are the list QL bar sheaves of rank one. So yesterday we only considered them, I mean, with these characters with Q mod Z coefficients. So this corresponds to this rank one sheaves with finite monodromy, but you can also do it for general ones with QL bar coefficients. And then this is also, these are also those list QL bar sheaves on this complement with Artin conductor is smaller, it's bounded by D. And then we get again this formula here. C is greater or equal to. Okay, yeah, so here, I mean, yeah, so this follows just from, I mean, computing the, trying to understand this reciprocity sheaves, and then you plug this in the general formula. So far, so this was the part with where we can say something also with modulus. And now we come to proper correspondence actions on reciprocity sheaves. And then somehow we don't see the modulus anymore because for this correspondence actions, we cannot do it at the moment with modulus. So let me say what we can do. So we fix S is now finite type separated K scheme, but it can be singular. And we consider now the category of proper Chow correspondences. And I will just say proper correspondences in the following. So this is a category where the objects are the S schemes, which have the following properties. So they are smooth and quasi-projective over K, and they are finite type over S. But this, there's no condition on this morphism F here. And X is smooth over K. And then the morphisms, so I will just write X for such a thing. It's an S scheme. And so the morphisms from two S schemes of this form, from X to Y, these are given by cycles whose dimension is the dimension of X and which are supported on this product here, X times Y over S and are proper over X. And so if X and Y are connected. And so this is like, so in Wojcicki's category, so finite correspondences, then you ask that it's finite over X, and then also you don't divide out the rational equivalences. And you don't take care of the support here. So now you can compose this, so you can use this really as morphisms. And to do this, you have to use Fulton's refined intersection product or refined in Gaussian map. Yeah, because what you do is, this thing here can be highly singular, of course. And what you do is you view this as a closed subset of X times Y over K, which is smooth. And then you pull back cycles, or you intersect them on the smooth scheme X times Y over S, but you mind the support, and you take care of the support, and that this works. This is for this you need really this refined intersection or this refined Gaussian map. And when you do this, then you can define a composition for this. And now we can define this correspondence actions in the following way. So F is now a reciprocity sheaf, and we have two such S schemes here. And we take alpha, a morphism in this category, from X to Y. Then we define alpha upper star. This is now a map in the derived category of Nisnevich sheaves of abelian groups on S between these two. Objects. So once we take F and restrict it to Y, and then we push it forward to S, and here we take F, we restrict it to X, and then we push it forward to S. And now we define this by first we pull back to X times Y. This product, over K, not over S. I mean, this it wouldn't be defined over S because this is not smooth. And then we take the cap product with this alpha, and we are minding the support. So we have to keep track of the support. And then we push forward to X. And for this, we really need the support, the properties of the support, because here these maps are not proper. We don't ask them to be proper. And so let me give some explanation to this, what I mean here by, so pullback is clear. Now, what do I mean by cap? Cap with alpha, minding the support. So that this works is really it. Well, first it works because of the Bloch formula. Yeah, so we take an alpha, and by definition, alpha is supported on a closed subset V, which lies inside X times Y over S, and which is proper over X. And then we can use the Bloch formula here to identify this with the E, so E is the dimension of Y, cohomology with support in V of X times Y of this Milner K sheaf E. So this you get directly from the Gersten resolution of the Milner K sheaf. And so we can interpret this alpha as a map from Z shifted by minus I to the the support in V of this Milner K sheaf, in the derived category, of course. And so we can define now this cap by alpha in the following way. So we start with gamma E F twisted by minus or shifted by minus E, and then we apply this alpha here, this map, and then we get a map here. Then we can, you have a natural map to when you move the support outside. And then you have a map, so there's this derived tensor product, you have a map then to the H0 of this, and then, so which is an F tensor Z with Milner K theory. And then you have a natural map of this tensor product to the tensor product where you go over this MPST, so where you take the transfers also to account. And then we use the definition of this gamma E again, which we defined as this, but somehow this required these formulas or these computations, which I said something about yesterday, so that this really makes sense. And then you can do the adjunction map to go here. And so you get this is a cap with the alpha. And for the push forward, well, I mean, this is essentially classical. So we had already the projective bundle formula, and I said that there's the Gesine map. So this is why, of course, we have to work with quasi-projective schemes, because here the idea is that you embed things into a projective space, and then you take the trace for the projective space, which comes from the projective bundle formula. And then, then you have to use a cancellation. So I say a word more on this, but the point is we have to work with supports everywhere. Because the X is quasi-projective, so you have only an immersion into projective space, and then but then you have a support which is proper. So then you can also view this as something with support on the whole projective space, and there then you have the trace. And then we need the cancellation. So I should have said here, this is a result here by Merici and Saito, this cancellation result, which I mentioned yesterday. And so this we need, because when you do this whole progress, then you end up here with something which is of the form gamma E and then F shifted by E. And then that you really come to this, so you need the cancellation. Okay, and so when you do this and you check all kinds of compatibilities, then you get a functor. So every reciprocity sheaf now defines you a functor from this category here of proper correspondences to the derived category of Nisnewitz sheaves. And then this functor is, of course, functorial in F also. And so now let me give some applications of this, yeah, of this general formalism. And this is still now in this work with Binda and Saito. So as the first application, we get obstructions for the existence of zero cycles of degree one. So let me say what I mean by this. So we take F as a reciprocity sheaf, and we have smooth schemes X and S, and we have a projective dominant map between this, and we have big K as a function field of S. And now assume that you have a degree one zero cycle on the generic fiber of this map. Then it follows that that the pullback here is split injective. Well, I mean, I formulated it in a way, that there's a hope to check or decheck this condition. But of course, you get the split injection really on the level of complexes in the derived category also. But so in particular, this there's a chance that you can disprove that something has a degree one cycle. Yeah. So I mean, here you have a function field, yeah, and several variables, and you have then a projective, smooth projective scheme over K, and you ask yourself, does this have a K rational point? Or then you say, maybe a little bit weaker, does it have at least a zero cycle of degree one? And you could try to spread out your function field, I mean, to a nice geometric situation, and the F, if you're lucky, you can do it. Yeah, I mean, and then you can look at this pullback, and if you then find some F, some reciprocity sheaf, and you find some cohomological degree where this is not split injective, yeah, where here you get a Z mod P and here you get a Z mod P square or something, yeah, then you know this is not split injective, and then you know, okay, there cannot exist a rational point, a K-rational point, or there can even not exist a degree one cycle. So this is why this is an obstruction to the existence of this. And
just a question. Do you have a sort of a concrete example for this?
Yeah, yeah, that's the other point, of course. I mean, these things are quite hard, actually, to find examples. Yeah, so I mean, there's a whole industry. I mean, not in this generality. I mean, so far, I think machines like this were only available when S was coming from a global field. And we only have the hope that this will be useful in an explicit situation. Yeah, but it's always very hard, and you have to be very clever, and it's usually not as naive as I say now to really make this idea work. Yeah, but
okay.
Yeah. But there are examples that when S is a global field. Then there are examples in on the hypersurface range and so on. I mean, so explicit examples where this works. So at the moment, I only hope that it works. This gives you an obstruction. And but the proof is very easy now. I mean, once we have this action of correspondences, namely, so we have this psi, then we can. So it's a sum of certain points here, then we just take the closure inside X, and so we can identify X with this, so we can take a lift of Xi to this, and but this here is by definition just the morphisms from S to X in this category. And so we have here this Xi upper star, which now goes from here to here, and we have also the F upper star, which is this. And then of course you can also show that this F upper star is the same as when you let the cycle given by the graph of F when you let it act, and then you can show that this composition is actually the same as when you compose this cycle psi together with the graph, and then it's a completely cycle theoretic computation, which was done by Fulton, for example, that this is then the same as when you take this cycle and you push it forward along F, and since this psi was a one cycle, then this you get a cycle of degree one, sorry, you get here just S, and this of course acts as identity. Yeah? So this is how you get this the splitting. So once you have this this action of correspondences, this is just an observation. Yeah, but well, hopefully it's can be useful at some point. Okay, then in this spirit, we can also generalize the Brauer-Mahnen abstraction for zero cycles. Yeah, so this has been useful to show that one cycles exist and not exist when S is a global field. Of course, yeah, we cannot deal with the number theoretic side. Yeah, we can only consider like the function theoretic side, but here we are a little bit more general since we don't, so S is now a regular projective curve, but over a function field. It does not need to be a finite field. And then we look here at the function field of S, and we have F is projective and dominant from X to S, and we take a closed point in S. Then when we take a zero cycle here, so KV is now the Henselization of K at V, and then SV is the spectrum of the local ring of the Henselization. So when we have a zero cycle here, then we can lift it again by taking the closure to one cycle here over SV. And then this one we can let act, I mean, actually on RF lower star here, but in particular it gives us such a map. But since here the restriction to the generic fiber is injective, then you also see that this only depends on alpha V. Yeah, so this is not on this, not on the lift you take. So this is why I call it phi alpha V. And now you can, to this map, you apply the first cohomology with support in V. So you get this map here, and then you have a natural map further. So this shows that you, from such a product here of zero cycles on the over this local fields or over the Henselizations, you get a map to the homomorphisms. Yeah, by sending, I mean, when you take a tuple of alpha V's here, then you assign this map here to it, and it takes a sum. And then we have this other map also. So here, I mean, what is this? This is a local discrete valuation ring in the spectrum of it. When I take out the closed points, so this is just spec of KV, and then of course I have a natural map from here to here. But the way I write it here so complicated is that you see that then here I get this boundary map from the localization sequence into this sum, and then the theorem somehow, which is a I will say it in a minute. So why it gives you an abstraction for zero cycles is that if you have such a tuple here of zero cycles here, and the composition with this map, and so you can pre-compose it with this. If this is not zero, then there can also not exist a global cycle which maps to this one. And well, I think this point of view, this is like an abstraction to the Hasse's principle. And this point of view was introduced by Shuji Saito, I think. And and of course, I mean, in this generality again, I mean, it's hard to see something. But the hope is that, and when you do explicit examples here, then you are in a shape where you can actually compute these terms, and where you see that it doesn't vanish, and so you see that your bunch of cycles here, so maybe you have here just a bunch of rational points on the fibers, then it does not come from a global point, from a global cycle. And the proof is also easy again now. So when we have such an alpha V here, such a tuple, we assume it lies in the image, so we have such an alpha, then we can also again take a lift. Yeah, so we take a closure, we get a cycle on X, And then, this was here, this map psi. Yeah, psi of alpha v is this morphism. And then when we precompose it with iota, we get this morphism. But when this alpha v here is in the image, so if we have an alpha which maps to this alpha v, then we also get such a commutative diagram here. So this is alpha upper star, but this just induces a map like this. And but now this composition here is zero. And so this follows from the fact that how we define iota. Yeah? So there's some of the localization sequence in it. So you do two successive maps in the localization sequence, and then this is zero. And so you see when it comes from a global thing and you do this composition, then it should be zero. Okay. And so the remark is, if you take K is a finite field and F is a Brouwer group, so we saw yesterday that the Brouwer group gives a reciprocity sheaf, yeah, then this map psi becomes this one here, where for this part you use a class field theory. And then this gives you the classical Brouwer-Mahnen obstruction for zero cycles. Yeah. So, and I think, this form is maybe was considered by Saito, but there were other forms. I mean, so I think Mahnen first was just asking about obstructions for, so you have rational points here, and then does it come from a rational point over the global field? And then this gives you an obstruction. So this generalizes this to other fields and other reciprocity sheaves. And of course, the hope is that this is useful, but again, unfortunately, so far we don't have an example directly. And so let me come to another topic, to stable birational invariance, or just birational invariance. So again, we can take S schemes like here, and X and Y are integral. X and Y are always smooth, yeah, but S is not smooth in general. And then we say that they are properly birational over S if there exists a map from Z. So this is also an S scheme, and we have a proper birational map to X and to Y. And now I just see that this is the wrong sign here. So this should not be, so there should be just one tilde, not this equality. So it's not an isomorphism here, but it should be just birational. Yeah? So an isomorphism on a dense open. Yeah, and the standard situation which you should keep in mind is that S is singular, and you take a resolution here, and you take another resolution here, and then they are properly birational over S. They are stably birational over S if you find vector bundles V on X and W on Y, such that the corresponding projective bundles are properly birational over S. And then one theorem, which now also follows easily from the formalism, is that if you have any reciprocity sheaf, then this is a stably properly birational invariant over S, in the sense that when you have two such S schemes here, which are stably properly birational, then you get the same sheaves here on S. Yeah, and of course, I mean, in particular, you can say you could take S to be a field and Y to be a field. Yeah, so G is an identity, and then that something is stably properly birational over the that F is stably birational to G just means that F is stably birational. So, which means when you take some bundle over X, then it is a projective bundle or a projective space. And so there are many important schemes. So many open questions where people ask whether this is a stably properly birational invariant, or I mean whether a certain hypersurface is stably birational. Yeah, so it's when you take a product with a PN, is it then birational to a PM? And so examples like this. So for example, I think Kohli Otelen and Pirotka, they were using those so such invariants to prove that certain schemes are not stably birational. Stably rational, sorry. But they were using this for when you consider Q mod Z, and then for S is just K. Okay, so and the proof here is again easy. This follows from the projective bundle formula. Yeah, so to keep track of this part here, and then you use purity and this correspondence action. And so there's also a birational invariance of cohomology, so that not just in degree zero you have an isomorphism, but really in the whole cohomology. But for this doesn't work for all reciprocity sheaves. I mean, for this you definitely have to impose some extra conditions. And so one condition which you can impose is like this here. So you twist it in the sense of yesterday, yeah, with one. So it's like you tensor it as a reciprocity sheaf with GM. And then it should be zero when you restrict it to X and to Y. And then you have really that this is the same. Yeah? So which means you get here these complexes which are like independent of S. Yeah. So when you have resolutions here, two different resolutions, you still get the same complex. And then, which means that this complex here kind of encodes only properties of S. It's independent of the resolution. It just depends on S. And then you can try to study this S using this these complexes. Yeah? So that's a way, I mean, when you take F to be the O or to be the top differential forms, and this is related to rational singularities. And but you also get vanishing results here. So if S is, for example, smooth, you can take S just as Y and G is the identity. And then, of course, you get here that Ri F lower star is zero when I is greater than equal one. And so the theorem here is also explained easily. So this kind of attack to these kind of questions, this we did earlier also with André Hatzista Matteo, where we considered differential forms and Deram-Witt forms, but it wasn't working in this generality, and it was the philosophy was a little bit different, but it's very similar. So we take such a Z, which maps proper and birationally to X and Y. Yeah, so we know it exists here by this assumption. And then when we compose this Z, we can view this now as a cycle or as a morphism here in this category of proper correspondences. We compose it with its transpose. Then once we have the diagonal of Y in it, yeah, because Z is an isomorphism over an open, yeah, it's birational to X. And then we have some other part, some rest, which when you project it to Y, it maps to something which has higher codimension in Y. And then this condition here is needed, this vanishing, to show that this epsilon upper star actually acts then as zero on this complex. So which means that this composition here acts just as delta upper star, which is the identity. And then you can also do it the other way around. And then you use this vanishing, and then you see that they are inverse to each other, and so you have this isomorphism. And now let me give you some examples where one can use this. Yeah? So this here is a strange condition, maybe when you look at it the first time, and essentially it says that this F has to be of top dimension. So let me say, you know what I mean by this. So assume that dimension X and dimension Y they are equivalent to D. And then the theorem, which I just stated, applies for the following Fs. So I can take as F just the Keller differentials over K. So this assumption should not be necessary. Yeah, it's just a technical point. But you can also take this one here, which is somehow a mixed thing. Yeah, this is homotopy invariant sheaf, this is a coherent sheaf, and so somehow before there wasn't really a nice way to deal with such mixtures, but here we can take this. And then, you can also take the Deram-Witt modulo B infinity or just without, you can also take the whole top forms in the Deram-Witt complex. You can take this part here of this motivic cohomology, and you can also build completely new sheaves. You can take G is a smooth unipotent K group, and then you twist it D times. Then you get something which in general is not known what it is. Yeah? When it's GA, then I said yesterday, then it's omega D modulo B infinity. And when it's WN, then probably it's this. But a general unipotent group is just a quotient of a direct sum of WNs, and so then it's not clear what you get here. So you get something new. It's the same here. You take this sheaf which parameterizes G torsors, where G is a finite K group or P group, then you get also the twisted D times, then you can also use this. And you can also take this if K is algebraically closed. Here, I mean, this birational invariance of the cohomology, this was known for the scalar differentials. Yeah, so this was proved on the level of cohomology sheaves here with André Kratzis-Tamatiu, and then this general version, really the isomorphism of the complexes, follows from work of Kovac. But he's in a completely different setup. He works just with coherent sheaves, and so with O modules. So for this last three here, to prove that this condition is satisfied, yeah, that F twisted by one is zero, we have to prove that this is satisfied here. Here we use this Bloch-Kato-Geber map isomorphism, and here we use this Wybodsky's proof of Milnor. No, we don't use Wybodsky's proof, we just use a statement of Milnor Bloch-Kato conjecture, but which was proved by Wybodsky, yeah, to check this condition. And there's also a version where we replace the condition on this one here by gamma F, and then this would give rise to like degree zero things, yeah, so like O and so on. But there, this we can do at the moment only when we assume resolutions of singularity. And another corollary which you get from this is also that if you have smooth schemes and X is proper over S and Y is proper, projective over S and flat, geometrically integral. And the generic fiber has index one, so that means that the generic fiber has a zero cycle of degree one. Then the Picard schemes are representable, and if you now assume that X and Y are stably properly birational, then you have this isomorphism of the torsion points as sheaves on S NIS. So this follows from these things before. And so this was known if, couldn't find it explicitly, but definitely it was like in the literature implicitly if K is algebraically closed, but I think it wasn't known in this generality. So at the end, in the last 2 minutes, let me just come to another point. So once you have actions of correspondences, and of course you get nice implications also if you know that the diagonal decomposes. So assume now, so K is a function field and X is smooth over the function field at dimension D. And then we say that the diagonal of X decomposes if the class of the diagonal in the Chow group here is of this form, so it's a zero cycle, so just like a bunch of points here, and we pull it back. And then it's a cycle here which has a higher co-dimension on the in the first variable. And so such conditions was considered first by Bloch-Srinivas, and they were mostly working with tensor Q, but so this is a little bit weaker. And then they were already observing that this has strong implications on certain cohomologies. And Collio-Telene and Pirutkas showed that this, so if X is smooth and projective and it is retract rational, then it has this property. Yeah. So retract rational means that there's an open dense U in X and V in a projective space, and then there's a map from V to U, which has a section. So, So implications of this on cohomology yield therefore obstructions for X being a retract rational over K. And now let me say what we have here. So when S is either now a local discrete valuation field, a Hinsilian discrete valuation ring of geometric type, or it's a regular connected affine finite type K scheme of dimension less or equal one. So it's a curve or it's a field. And then we have F is smooth projective from X to S. And then we assume that the diagonal of the generic fiber decomposes as just defined. Then we have this equality. So the pullback here induces an isomorphism. And so this follows also immediately from like injectivity results and the proper correspondence action. And but let me remark that there's a recent paper by All and Bigazzi, Böning, Graf von Bodmer, where they pose the following problem. So they say K is algebraically closed of positive characteristic and assume X is smooth proper over K and test the decomposition of the diagonal. Do we have this vanishing? So the P is a characteristic here. And the theorem here says yes, at least if X is projective. Namely, we take S here just to be the spectrum of the field. We take F to be this reciprocity sheaf. And then you can see directly that F of K is zero. So you get it. And so somehow we only saw this after we have written down this thing here, but it's a vast generalization of this. This problem. And so at the very end, let me just say so that if we have another restriction on the reciprocity sheaf, so if you only allow certain reciprocity sheaves, then the decomposition of the diagonal also gives a stronger result. So we can really get this whole relative cohomology where D is again like the top dimension here, can express it then like this. So it's just a shifted sheaf, and this is the case in the following examples, so these are essentially the same examples as before, yeah? So in all these cases. So for example, we get a stronger statement than what I just had on the other side. Yeah, if K is algebraically closed and X over K is smooth, and the diagonal of X decomposes, then we get that all these cohomologies here vanish. Yeah, again, you take just S to be K, and then E is zero, and you get this. Okay, so I think this was all which I wanted to say. Sorry for going over time, and thank you for listening.
Thanks a lot, Kai, for sharing all your insight on this fascinating topic. Maybe I can ask the first question. So are there any problems for the rest of us to work on in this subject? Or do you have some sort of favorite open problems?
Well, I mean, there are many. So one was, before this, Grigory Gakusha was asking me whether reciprocity sheaves form a subcategory of pre-sheaves with transfers. Yeah, and so this is an open problem, for example. Yeah, so it's not clear when you have an extension of reciprocity sheaves. So you have a short exact sequence. The outer parts are reciprocity sheaves. Is the inner one a reciprocity sheaf? There are, what are other open problems? Then of course, yeah, if you are more on the computational side, yeah, then of course you can always try to compute this. This modulus sheaves, which I said yesterday. Yeah? Once you computed this in one part, I mean, then you can apply these formulas which I had at the beginning, and you get then general formulas which take care of pole orders or ramification or so, for projective bundle formula and Gaussian sequences and so on. And and then of course there is this thing I guess you really want is like a nice category, a motivic triangulated motivic category behind, and of course this is also missing. And I have to say,
can I interrupt you? What do you mean by a nice triangulated category behind? You mean using your reciprocity sheaves?
Mm. Yeah, so something which represents cohomology. When you have the cohomology of the reciprocity sheaf, that you can write it as the homomorphisms in a certain motivic category from a motive to something.
I see. So if we are given chain complexes of Nisnevich sheaves with transfers whose cohomology are reciprocity sheaves, right?
Hmm. With this, we cannot work at the moment nicely.
Yeah, but it does not mean that it does not exist.
Yeah, but I mean, so this is like an open...
hopefully one can repair this lack of...
I have to say at the moment, I think that this approach by Binder and Park and Ostwer is maybe more elegant. So they have this, they work with these log schemes, and this gives you a nice way to put this, like this cube invariance on it. And then, they allow also more sheaves. Yeah? So for example, like an infinite product of cube invariant sheaves in their sense, or also in this sense here, this would be cube invariant again, but it won't be a reciprocity sheaf. So some reciprocity sheaf is more restrictive. Yeah? So maybe you get a nice formalism more when you really work with this this log sheaves.
I don't know why you are struggling for the existence of all products of reciprocity sheaves, or why you are saying about infinite products, because for example, if you take a naive example, if you take abelian groups, mm-hmm. and set localizing subcategory of torsion subgroups, yeah, mm-hmm. and this is a nice localizing subcategory which is not a closed under product.
Yeah, sure. I just wanted to say that cube invariant sheaves, you have much more cube invariant sheaves in whatever sense than reciprocity sheaves.
Yeah, so I understand.
This is what I wanted to say, and I wanted to say that maybe like you get a nice. That something is a reciprocity sheaf is just another constraint. So it's like you work with O modules, and then within O modules you find coherent O modules or quasi coherent O modules where you put another constraint, and to have certain formulas working and in the whole generality you have to leave the world of coherent O modules, but then to have nice formulas or finiteness results you have to restrict and so maybe something like this you have to do, yeah. So
yeah, but anyway, if I clearly understand, for example, if we pass into the category of log mode, log DM, log DM, yeah, then all theory works. I mean, all cohomology theories are representable there.
All.
No, I mean, we have a nice theory of DM.
I think at the end, everything will be representable there. As far as I understand, it's not yet written. Yeah, but I mean, there's, you have to.
Oh, Kai, there's something in the chat, if you can have a look at that, and maybe comment on that.
For single sheaf. Yeah.
Yeah, this is what I mean.
This is true. I mean, for a single sheaf, I can do this. I can embed this reciprocity sheaf.
And represent in the larger category.
Yeah, yeah. But then, but at the moment, you don't see in this larger category. In this framework of log motifs or. This cube invariant sheaves in this log sense, you don't see this filtrations, yeah. So this higher poles, this ramification filtration, yeah? Which I try to make. I try to make the point that this gives you interesting objects, yeah. Also objects that were studied before and which were worth to be understood in this context or in a more general framework. But I believe, I mean, there should be a way to put it there. Yeah? I mean, to see this. What does he say? Rico, but in LogDM we don't have higher modulus exactly. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah. Federico is also saying this.
Yes. Maybe I can say it. I can say it myself. Yes. But what Kai was saying is exactly the point. I mean, there is there is an overlap in the sense that somehow some, if you don't care about ramification filtration, then you can deduce some of the results that Kai was presenting from analogous results in logDM thanks to Shuji's embedding theorem. But on the other hand, and those results, so I mean, in logDM are in a sense more general because you prove them for motives, but are also more restrictive because you cannot deal with higher modulos. So I hope this sort of explains that. I mean, the two things are kind of companions at the moment.
Sorry, yeah. The existence of, for example, of nice category with RSC cohomology can fix this problem of for higher module, what you have written in your last comments.
Yeah, but I mean, this seems to be extremely hard. I mean, to construct a category of motives such as the local objects are exactly complexes, say bounded complexes of reciprocity sheaves. I mean, this doesn't seem to work.
Well, and this is, so what I wanted to say is that maybe it doesn't work, but so to have a nice working category where you can represent things by motives, you have to allow more sheaves. So like just cube invariant sheaves, and then the reciprocity sheaves is just, I mean, they just form a certain subcategory in there, yeah, and which you, so.
So if I clearly understand, at the moment you don't know the right bigger subcategory which contains reciprocity sheaves.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Okay, great. Other questions? Okay, last chance for a question. Doesn't seem to be the case. So then let's all unmute and give Kai an applause for this wonderful lecture series.